Hi, bio people. Today we're going to discuss Griffiths and also Hershey and Chase. Both of these experiments were very important in discovering exactly how genetic material can be passed on from parent to offspring. Griffiths' experiment happened first in 1928, and so we're going to discuss that one first. Griffiths' experiment proved that bacteria are capable of passing on genetic information. Bacteria are capable of undergoing something called transformation. He thought that information might be passed between organisms, which might cause them to assume a different form. Pneumonia was a major cause of death at the time of Griffiths' experiment, and so he chose to experiment using the Pneumonia bacterium. Griffiths also knew that there were two different strains of the Pneumonia bacterium. The rough strain, or the R strain, was relatively safe, whereas the smooth strain, or the S strain, was pretty dangerous and almost always killed the subject. Normally, anybody infected with the rough strain would survive, and anyone infected with the smooth strain would die. Griffiths tried four different combinations. He first injected the R strain into a healthy mouse and the S strain into a healthy mouse. Predictably, the mouse involved with the R strain survived. The mouse who was injected with the S strain died. This was fairly predictable, but the next two steps show why Griffiths' experiment was groundbreaking. Remember this structure from the fall? This structure that we drew way back when represented an enzyme, which is a type of protein. Notice that it has a very specific shape. If the goal of this enzyme is to put together these two substrates like this, it must have this exact shape in order for the substrates to fit nicely. If this enzyme or protein is subjected to any kind of heat, cold, acid, or force, it will change its shape. Now, even though this protein still has two openings, or activation sites, the substrates can no longer bind to it the way that they should. Remember also that we call this process denaturation. Griffiths hypothesized that the specific shape of a bacterium would allow it to do something very similar. Using its very specific shape, the bacterium would be able to bond to other substances inside the body. However, if you expose it to heat, cold, acid, or force, the substrates would no longer be able to bind to the bacterium, and the bacterium would not be able to function normally. Griffiths exposed his bacteria to the heat source. When exposed to the heat, the bacterium changed their shape. Of course, he wasn't able to see the bacteria change its shape, but he was able to conclude that this is what had happened. When he took the heat-killed S strain, which used to be deadly, and injected it into a mouse, amazingly enough, the mouse survived. Heating the S strain bacteria had caused them to become denatured, so they no longer were deadly. Griffiths then combined heat-killed S strain with live R strain. Remember, R strain bacteria are not considered to be deadly, and heat-killed S strain bacteria are not considered to be deadly. However, when he combined the two of them and injected it into the mouse died. Griffiths hypothesized that even though the S strain bacteria had been denatured by the heat, that there were still components of it that were still active. He thought that the components of the S strain bacterium were going into the R strain bacterium and corrupting it somehow. This could cause what was previously an innocuous R strain to become a toxic R strain. We call this transformation. Now let's talk about Hershey and Chase. At the time, most people thought that the molecule of heredity was contained within proteins. Almost no one believed that the molecule of heredity was nucleic acids. Proteins are so complex that it wasn't that big of a stretch to imagine that there might be a nose-shaped protein, or a height protein, or a personality set of proteins. There are approximately 150,000 different proteins in the human body. Remember that proteins are made up of 20 different amino acids, which are arranged in very complicated patterns and shapes. This leads to a huge number of potential combinations. Nucleic acids are much simpler. There are only four different kinds of nucleotides, and there are only a few different types of nucleic acids, DNA, and a few different types of RNA. Hershey and Chase set out to prove which of these two things, proteins or nucleic acids, was responsible for passing along genetic material. They chose to do their work using bacteriophages. Bacteriophages have several different advantages, including the fact that they reproduce very quickly and are only made up of two of the big four, nucleic acids, and proteins. They don't contain any lipids or carbohydrates. So here we can see that this bacteriophage has a protein coat on the outside and then nucleic acids on the inside. Bacteriophages reproduce by attaching to the outside of a host cell. Then they inject their genetic material into it. The protein coat stays on the outside of the host cell. The DNA from the bacteriophage then causes the cell to stop whatever it was doing and begin producing copies of the bacteriophage. The new bacteriophages are identical to the parent bacteriophage that originally infected the cell. The host cell then explodes, releasing all of the new bacteriophages, which then go out and infect even more cells. Hershey and Chase used this life cycle to prove which of the two contenders was actually responsible for inheritance, nucleic acids or proteins. Hershey and Chase used two groups of bacteriophages. In one group, they chose to test the protein coat, and in the other group, they chose to test the nucleic acids. To test the two options, they decided to make parts of each type of bacteriophage radioactive. They knew that whichever part was responsible for genetic inheritance would create radioactive baby bacteriophages. For the protein coat, they made the protein coat radioactive. Since proteins contain the element sulfur, they decided to use a radioactive type of sulfur. The type of sulfur they used is called sulfur 35. Since sulfur is not found in nucleic acids, they were only marking the protein coat. For the nucleic acid group, they decided to replace the naturally occurring phosphorus in the nucleic acids with a radioactive type of phosphorus called phosphorus 32. Since there was no phosphorus found in the protein coat, the only thing they were marking in the second group was the nucleic acids. Hershey and Chase then allowed each type of bacteriophage to infect a host cell. They knew that whichever type was responsible for inheritance would create radioactive bacteriophages. The bacteriophages then injected their genetic material into the two host cells. Remember, the protein coat is left on the outside of the host cell and only the DNA gets injected. Hershey and Chase then shook the compounds in a blender to shake the protein coats off the outside of the cells. The protein coats then dissolved in the liquid portion of the experiment, which is called the supernatant. So now each blender has a liquid portion which contains the dissolved protein coats and a solid portion that contains everything else. However, at the moment, they are mixed together in the blender, and so we need to separate them. To separate the liquids from the solids, the scientists then put the mixture into a centrifuge, which spins very fast and separates components based on density. After spinning the components in the centrifuge, we now had a liquid portion containing the protein coats and a solid portion containing everything else. We call the solid portion the pellet. Hershey and Chase then tested both the pellet and the supernatant in each case to determine which of them was radioactive. Remember, the goal was to make radioactive bacteriophages, which would be found in the pellet. In the situation where they had tagged the protein coat, the supernatant was radioactive. However, the pellet containing the new bacteriophages was not radioactive, and so they decided that that must not be the molecule of inheritance. In the case of the radioactive nucleic acids, however, all of the new bacteriophages contained within the pellet were radioactive, and this told them that nucleic acids was actually the molecule of inheritance.